Hello everyone, this is Dr. Fox. Let's talk about the locations and positions of the kidney. In this video, we'll discuss the location of the kidneys within the abdomen and relate the basic superficial features of the kidney to their positions. With respect to the entirety of the urinary system, there are paired kidneys within the retroperitoneal space that are lying lateral to the spinal column and aorta and inferior vena cava. These kidneys are dynamic filters for the blood, and any of the filtrate which becomes urine is then drained through ureters that descend the abdomen and enter into the pelvis to drain into the urinary bladder. And that urinary bladder is then drained to the external environment by means of a urethra. The kidney itself has two borders and two poles. Laterally, there are the convex lateral borders, and medially, the borders are convex superiorly and inferiorly, and concave in a region known as the hilum. The hilum is where the neurovasculature and the renal pelvis, which is the structure that drains the urine from the kidney, exists. There are also superior and inferior poles. The superior poles tend to be in association with the suprarenal glands or adrenal glands, and the inferior poles tend to be about 2.5 to 3.5 centimeters superior to the iliac crest. Sometimes there are special types of accessory renal arteries which can be found serving the regions of the poles that are called polar arteries. So keep your eyes out for those. The hilum of the kidney. A hilum is an area where neurovasculature enters and exits. The hilum of the kidney includes several major elements. There's the renal artery, and that renal artery is going to divide into various segmental arteries within the hilum. There may also be accessory renal arteries that serve the hilum. There are the renal vein within the hilum and the renal pelvis, which is contiguous with the ureter within the hilum of the kidney. That hilum of the kidney, if we move more laterally, it is going to be contiguous with a space called the renal sinus, which is surrounded by the parenchyma of the kidney, as we'll see. In terms of their relative positions, the left kidney tends to be a little higher than the right kidney, although that's not evident in this particular photograph. The left kidney tends to have its superior pole out at about the T11 vertebral level, and its inferior pole down to the L2 level, so T11 through L2, whereas the right kidney tends to be a little lower, and that's because we have a very large liver occupying that right upper quadrant. The superior pole of the right kidney tends to be at about the T12 level, and its inferior pole tends to be at the L3 level. We say that the kidneys are within the paravertebral gutter. That's a difficult space to really appreciate looking at a frontal view, but when we see more of a transverse section, this will become more evident. To really understand that, we need to understand that deep to these vessels here, deep to this neurovasculature, is the vertebral column. And so the kidneys are lateral to the vertebral column in this space that that we call the paravertebral gutters. The hilum of the kidneys are at approximately the L1 level. And that L1 level anatomically is oftentimes referred to as the transpyloric plane. The transpyloric plane, if you were to think of this from superficial landmarks, if you were to go from the suprasternal or the jugular notch down to the pubic symphysis, the transpyloric plane would be approximately the midpoint of those two palpatable landmarks. It corresponds with where the stomach, which I'm kind of crudely drawing in here, where the pyloric part of the stomach is going to feed into the duodenum of the small intestines. Now the hilum of the kidneys, and this is an important thing to note, these hilum are actually situated anteromedially. So they're not perfectly medial, and that's because the lateral borders of the kidneys are situated posterolaterally. These kidneys, even within the retroperitoneum, which we'll discuss, may change their position depending on what an individual is doing. So if they are standing or sitting upright, gravity may act upon them. As an individual breathes and their diaphragm depresses, they may move inferiorly, slightly, with that movement. And to really appreciate what we're seeing here, you would have to understand that all of the GI organs would be removed. And that's why we see the kidneys, or we encounter them through dissection, typically with our GI sessions, once we are able to remove a lot of those organs. And the organs which typically obscure the kidney are those that are derived from the embryonic foregut. So the stomach, the duodenum, the pancreas, things such as that. So within the abdomen, the kidneys exist in the retroperitoneal space. We'll get into the granular details of the peritoneum in the GI sessions, but your short preview of it is that it is a serous membrane which lines the abdominal pelvic cavity. So that serous membrane will be both on the walls as well as on the viscera. And so we'll have both parietal and visceral components. And then we'll have the cavity between those parietal and visceral components. Well, the retroperitoneal space is everything which is posterior to that peritoneal membrane. And we can subdivide it a number of ways. Let me erase all of this. First, let's orient ourselves. So anterior is there, posterior is there, here is the midline, and this is the right side. And I can tell that because the liver is here. So this is an inferior view of what's going on. Let me just outline the kidney for us, because this is sort of the star of the show. So that is the kidney, and we can see that it is in the retroperitoneal space. Here is that parietal peritoneum that I'll outline. And that retroperitoneal space is divided into subspaces by various fascia. There are a number of ways that we can conceptualize this fascia, but if we look surrounding the kidney is the perirenal fascia. That perirenal fascia may be conceptualized a number of ways. So it might be considered one contiguous layer of fascia, or it may be conceptualized separately as an anterior layer of fascia, and this would be called Corrodus fascia. And there's also a posterior layer of fascia called Zuckerkandel's fascia. Which is there. And these two layers of fascia meet laterally. To form the lateroconal fascia. And that lateroconal fascia goes out to blend with the parietal peritoneum. So that's another way that we can conceptualize this space. So regardless of what we want to call these fascia or these fasci, for our purposes, we'll refer to everything as perirenal or renal fascia. We can see that there are pararenal spaces. So there is an anterior pararenal space and a posterior pararenal space. That anterior perirenal space will oftentimes, especially more anteriorly and medially, envelop various retroperitoneal GI elements. So sometimes it's referred to as the GI space, whereas the posterior perirenal space typically only contains adipose connective tissue or fat. Now, within this perirenal fascia is the perirenal with an I, perirenal space. And that perirenal space is going to contain the kidneys, the suprarenal glands, the proximal ureters, and a copious amount of perirenal adipose connective tissue. And this space also includes or invades the renal sinus, which we can see here. So very frequently, the entirety of the perirenal fascia is referred to as Corrodus fascia, even though in the technical sense of the term, Corrodus fascia is only the anterior aspect of that perirenal fascia. It's very dense, yet elastic. We can conceptualize it as kind of an inverted cone that is largest superiorly and is very variable in its course and its extent inferiorly. It tends to end at the common iliac vessels. We can see there's the common iliac artery and the common iliac vein would be there. And it's surrounding, we can't see it here because it's not pierced, but it's surrounding the suprarenal glands, the kidneys, and the ureters as they descend down in that retroperitoneal space. So here we can see that Corrodus fascia removed, and we can see the suprarenal gland. We can see the right kidney there. We can see the various hilar contents. So a renal artery, a renal vein, and an accessory renal artery. We can also see the hilum there going into the ureter, and we can see the perirenal fat, much of which has been removed in order for us to see this. So it's probably good to keep these contents in mind if you ever hear the terminology of a simple versus a radical nephrectomy. A nephrectomy is the removal of a kidney. A simple nephrectomy usually happens with some benign disease process that might necessitate the removal of the kidney, whereas a radical nephrectomy involves the removal, classically, of at least the kidney and oftentimes the suprarenal gland, the ureter, and all of the perirenal fat. So generally the entire contents of the perirenal space. So we've discussed the superficial features of the kidney, the various borders and poles, the hilum and how they are situated and their relative relationships to various vertebral levels. We've also discussed the spaces which surround the kidneys, so the anterior and posterior pararenal spaces superficial to the perirenal fascia, the perirenal space deep to the perirenal fascia. This is your summary slide. Thank you for your time.